Hey everyone, I'm Adam from Aleph Zero, and I'm gonna be talking about intent-driven designs. So maybe first question, who have heard the buzzword intent in the, let's say, DeFi space recently? And who knows what it stands for? Like, who could define? I mean, I'm not gonna ask for it, but... Okay, so it seems like half of people. So what is intent? Intents are, well, basically glorified limit orders. And I could end the presentation here because, like, really, this is what the intents are. They are limit orders. But usually when people are talking about intents, they have some very specific narrative on mind. And I'll try to show what this narrative is about. So classically in DeFi, how everything looks, or I'm gonna be focusing on token exchanges because this is like the staple of DeFi. So how it usually looks in DeFi is that someone, let's say, wants to exchange one ETH to USDT, sends one ETH to some smart contract, then some logic in this contract happens, and then USDT is sent back to the user. The user usually have some idea about how many USDT he's gonna get in return. There is a parameter called tolerance, so like he's not gonna accept too low number. But generally, the idea is that he wants to get as much as possible, and there is no strict requirement. When it comes to intents, it looks somewhat different. So what user is actually sending is a very specific intent, or actually you could say a limit order. So user says that, well, he owns one ETH and he wants exactly 2,400 USDT or more in exchange for this ETH. And where this intent lands is like a big pile of intents. It's not a smart contract that's gonna execute it by itself. It's just kind of like a heap of intents that are put there by various users. And then there are guys like solvers. They have teeth because this is a very competitive market of the solvers. They are kind of aggressive, but very useful. So what happens then, they are fighting with each other to get this intent and make it filled. And here, like, what they are usually doing is kind of their own strategy, so they can do whatever they want. Usually they route this intent through several smart contracts. Maybe they exchange it on different exchanges. Maybe they use their own personal funds to fill the intent. Anyway, they are trying to find the best way to fill the intent using entire chain and all the smart contracts that are on this chain. So this is like a very competitive market where to fill an intent, instead of going to just one smart contract, like all chain is there, and there is a competition among this competitive solvers to use entire chain and everything what's there to fill the intent, or maybe even get more. So usually, like the idea is that the user should get slightly more than he asked for. So for example, here it's 2,408. And the nature of this competition among solvers should be so that the solutions which are giving more to the users are winning. So the key question when it comes to this intent-driven designs is, how do we actually choose which solver gets to fill the intent? Because what we want is some kind of a game that on one hand will promote the solvers with better solutions, and on the other hand will not incur too much of the additional gas costs. I mean, what we want is we want as cheap transactions for the users as we can. So first, we want to choose the best solutions because that's how user will get cheap transactions. And the other thing is we don't want to user to spend too much on the gas cost for the solver game itself, because then that would counter these optimalities that we're fighting for. So there, and by the way, currently with intent-driven designs, there are two which are well-known, Uniswap X and CowFi, and they indeed offer much better prices than any single smart contract, like for example, Uniswap, because this game-related overhead is really small, and, well, like, the solvers can be using all the available DEXs, not just the Uniswap one. Okay, so there are two types of games that the solvers are playing. And, well, maybe that's because there are two well-known protocols that are intent-driven right now. So off-chain open bid auction, this is the way that Kaufi is going about it. And on-chain Dutch auction, this is what Uniswap X is doing right now. So off-chain open bid auction means that there is an intent, and the solvers are, without using the chain, playing bids and saying how much more they can give to the user. And the one who wins the bid gets the right to actually fill the intent. And one can think, well, why is this game played off-chain, not on-chain? So like, this is Ethereum, everything on-chain is super expensive. We want it to be cheap. So the solver which wins the game then executes a normal transaction on-chain. So like, there is basically zero game-related overhead. So there are several goals here I'm gonna be comparing here. So one of the goals is to be cheap. Like, we are fighting for this small fractions of percentages of the price, so we don't want to lose it all on the gas prices. So when it comes to off-chain auction, this is like absolutely optimal gas price, because all this solver game does not incur any additional gas prices. When it comes to on-chain Dutch auction, on the other hand, it has somewhat suboptimal gas price, in the sense that, well, there needs to be a smart contract which is orchestrating this Dutch auction. And while Dutch auction is generally blockchain friendly, still, this is, the gas cost is slightly more than it would be if the transaction would be just executed. The other thing, it's important. So, like, when in this off-chain open bid auction, when someone wins the auction, it happens off-chain, and no one else has the right to execute the transaction. So there is no gas bidding war possible. Like, there is no one else who could claim to fill this particular intent. The game is finished off-chain. There is one person which can legally fill the intent, and like, no one should be front running this person, because there is no sense in that. It's already established who will fill the intent. When it comes to on-chain Dutch auction, bidding wars are absolutely possible. So Dutch auction usually works in a way where, in each time point, we ask auctioneers to auctionees to come with the solutions with a specific price. And it very much can happen that there is more than one solver with the very same solution. So what they can do is they can try to front run each other. So they get first, and they actually get to fill the intent. Why is this bad? Well, because if solvers are spending some funds on this gas bidding wars, this means that the user does not get optimal solution. I mean, optimal solution would be if solver would not spend any excess funds for any kind of fighting, any kind of games, but only optimize for the user price. If solver is spending funds on anything else, that means that, well, the actor who's going to be paying for that is the user, because of course no solver will be paying from his own pocket for this kind of games. So what we would like it to be also is relatively trustless, or, well, actually fully trustless and decentralized. So here the situation flips, because when it comes to off-chain auctions, they are not trustless, in the sense that whoever wins the auction, well, the information about the winner is not on-chain. So the solvers need to respect the game, and they need to respect who won the off-chain game. That's why in Kaufi, solvers need to have collateral, substantial collateral actually. Right now, I think they want $500,000 of collateral just to be a solver. And that's because if a solver would go malicious, he could stop respecting this auction game. The solver could just on-chain try to fill every intent without respecting this off-chain game on winning the intent to be filled. So if someone would do that, of course, the collateral would be slashed. But generally, it's somewhat problematic. I mean, this collateral is substantial. It limits the number of solvers available. So when it comes to on-chain Dutch auctions, this is fully permissionless, so no collateral is required for solvers, and it's fully trustless, and it's also much more simple. Like this this off-chain game that happens in CoFi is generally pretty complicated, and unfortunately CoFi needs some time to do some manual action when it comes to figuring out who is playing fair and who is not. I'm not gonna go too much into details, but this is pretty, the rules there are pretty complex. So it varies, I think, DAO there, but definitely that requires manual decisions. Next goal is make solvers always submit the best trade possible. When it comes to on-chain Dutch auction, this is partially true. So for those of you who knows how Dutch auction works, or for those who doesn't, Dutch auction is the type of auction where in each moment we are looking for a slightly worse solution. So as someone who wants to participate in the auction, I'm waiting for the moment in which my solution will get accepted finally. Because like the bar for acceptance of the solution goes down with time. So in case, blockchain is not continuous, it's rather discrete, like the blocks are happening every 12 seconds, like this is granular, it's not continuous. The decline of this bar is pretty granular. So like if the bar goes beyond what I have as a solution, I would probably submit not my best solution, but something slightly worse, which still goes above the bar. So yes, it's pretty incentivized to give the best solutions, not exactly. In this regard, the off-chain auction is doing a better job. So just also like the comment on the state of business right now, open Bit auction is definitely better on Ethereum. I mean, CoFi has the volume, I think, 10 or 20 times bigger than Uniswap X. So it seems that this gas prices aspect on Ethereum definitely wins. None of this protocol is deployed on any other chain but Ethereum. Like my prediction would be that whenever they get on L2s, the situation can flip, because on L2s the gas price is much less relevant. So I would predict that whenever these two are deployed on Arbitrum, Uniswap X can actually start winning with CoFi due to these factors being much less relevant. And the last thing, which is kind of our twist on it. So what we're working on is a model with what we call reveal conditions. So now what happens is Joe places this intent, let's say, or limit order, but it's encrypted. And there is a specific reveal condition attached to the order. So then periodically, all the reveal conditions are checked, and the orders with the reveal conditions which are satisfied are generally decrypted and are becoming active. So why we think it's nice is because, first, you can create iceberg orders. So you can put your order on chain in such a way that it's encrypted, and it automatically gets decrypted part by part. So it's an invisible order until it gets filled, when it becomes visible. So this is akin to what's happening on traditional markets, where vast majority of liquidity is actually hidden. So in crypto, to make it so right now, you actually need to have some kind of a bot that would be resubmitting transactions. So this is a cryptographic way to avoid having this off-chain actor. You can make your action on-chain once, and it's gonna be acting as an iceberg order. So this relates to the second point, that like traders without automated systems, like bots, can automate something by sending transactions on-chain once. The other thing is that using the system, I mean, I'm getting a bit out of time, but using the system, you can implement this solver games as well. So solvers can also put this encrypted intents, which will be decrypted at once and evaluated at this specific point. So you can write arbitrary rules for this solver game, and like it basically fills this framework. So we see it as a programmatic framework for kind of private trading. That's the last slide, or so we're out of time. So thanks a lot for listening. I think if anyone gets a question, it's better to ask off. Or
time. You have like 2 minutes for questions.
Well, perfect. So yeah, if anyone has a question, I'll be happy to answer now.